upstairs.
Oh, okay.
I guess that's the announcement there.
Yeah, give me just a second.
Okay. They're a little boy.
That's what Jeff was just telling me about.
Oh, okay. Yeah. He's really in bad shape.
He passed away.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
They think you did. But it hurts anyway. Even if you do expect it, it hurts.
Paula had
all right. Good evening, everybody. Glad you're all here. Didn't start off the night with many announcements, but they certainly filled in since we got here. Several people and families to be praying for. There's a little boy in town in Truett Palmer, 3-year-old.
He passed away last
month. Yeah. They live close to you, Chris, is that what I heard?
Back where they were.
Born with some pretty serious heart problems, and he passed away. Hard to even imagine that. So prayers for the Palmer family for sure. The family has been called in for Herbal Duncan. Her vital signs are very, very low, and it just kind of seems like it's a matter of time right now. So prayers for Amy and Marty and that whole family. Some better news, Glenda is home. If I heard right, she has a cousin staying with her for a bit. Is that right, Dan? A niece staying with her for a little bit to kind of help her as she progresses in her recovery. So hopefully that'll be quick, and she'll be back on her feet soon. Barbara Raspberry has been diagnosed with acute bronchitis, and it sounds like it's a pretty severe case, so she's having a rough time. Prayers for Barbara. Also, Linda Rushing, that's, of course, Martha's daughter. She's having a hysterectomy next Wednesday, I believe it is. So prayers if that goes well. You probably saw on Facebook, but Misty tested positive, so her, Steve, and Donna are all quarantining. I know Donna's having sonic withdrawals. Also, Vicki Smithson's sister, Lisa, she's positive, and she's having a really hard case, it sounds like. A lot of symptoms there. Prayers for her. And of course, for the others who have tested positive around here, Bradley, Sheckles, and there may be even some more that I'm not, not coming to mind right now. But is there anybody else we need to pray for tonight?
Larry Charles. He'd be mad if I knew if I was told. But anyway, tomorrow he is having a stress test. Mm-hmm. And just think about it.
Okay.
Larry.
Yep. Larry.
Neal.
Hopefully that'll go well.
Oh, yeah.
Anybody else? Okay, please remember Matthew 4:4 is tomorrow evening. We're still not able to really have people in the building and have the Bible class the way we want to, but keep that in your prayers. I'm hopeful that these people will maybe be mindful of the fact that we're trying to still take care of them in a really hard time. And I think that'll pay some dividends in the future if we can keep doing that. Remember Meals on Wheels coming up soon. There's a sign up sheet in the gym, or outside the gym. Sign up for that if you think you could be here for that meal, or if you'd like one delivered. We're gauging interest on that. Well, if there is nothing else, let's pray together tonight. Heavenly Father, God, thank you so much for tonight, letting us be here for a midweek Bible study. I think I can speak for all of us to say that we need this. It's kind of a particularly stressful time in our country right now, so to be able to get away from that and be together as your church, studying from your word, that's a pretty special thing. I'm thankful for that. We just ask that you would be with the teachers tonight and be with us as students. Help us to learn from your word and help us be changed by the things we talk about tonight. Now, God, there's so many people we mentioned tonight who need you. This Palmer family, it is difficult for us to even comprehend what they're going through right now with the loss of this little boy. We ask for your peace for them. That's a tall order to have peace at this time, I'm sure. But God, we just ask that you be at work in that situation and just help them to feel your love. But similarly for Amy and Marty, for their family, as everyone's been called in with Amy's mom, God, help them to lean on you for strength. Be with them during this really, really challenging time. Please be with Barbara as she's dealing with bronchitis. We ask for a quick recovery for her. For Linda, she's having surgery next week. We ask that everything would go well and she would be healthy again soon. For those who have tested positive, Misty, Vicki Smithson's sister, for Bradley, the Shackles, and anybody else, we just ask for the symptoms to be minimal and they be back to full health soon. And God, we're thankful for Glenda, that she is getting stronger, and certainly strong enough to go home. That's a huge step, and we ask that that process would continue, and she would be back on her feet as quickly as possible. God, we love you so much, and we are just so thankful for everything you do for us. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Greetings. Testing 1, 2. Testing 1, 2. Okay. Power. I'm eventually going to be electrocuted by this thing. I'm just resigned to the fact that some year it's going to happen. So nobody laughs when that occurs. So I had employees today that were like zombies from staying up and watching the election coverage last night. Anybody fall prey to that? I won't even ask for a show of hands.
Stay up
to 9:30. I found in kind of surveying people at the office that there was a couple of camps that broad camps that in watching the election results. One was somebody, people that stayed up and watched it for keep it in perspective, how we're really supposed to be oriented. Okay, that's good.
Ultimately, it is God's will.
Okay. So, recognizing the sovereignty of God and all of this.
The early Christians had to meet in hiding.
Yeah.
So, God's not worried about Republicans and Democrats. I'm sorry. And he's not.
You know?
Like, if the church thrived in persecution, why is he worried about political affiliation?
Yeah. And there's certainly a point to be made here. And I'll just add that I don't care where you're in my political views fall, on which side of whatever fence there be. Talking to Hudson about it last night, and six years of age, you know, he's all interested in what's happening and everything. And I said, but you know what, Lord, are the really important things are things that have to do with what? And he said, oh, God's will it is.
Yeah.
And I think that's so that's the perspective. But now, in the coming couple of weeks or months even, if I'm sitting there and I'm getting totally disgusted by what the other side, whatever side that would be from you or me, is doing, and this deal, this or that, and that, what am I doing? I'm reliving this to the degree that I'm being filled with resentment, potentially, for somebody who maybe just has a different political view than I do. And we got to see beyond that, and where those things impact, say, moral issues, we can be concerned about that, but that's not a qualitative or a judgment on the quality of the value of a person just because they feel differently than I do with regard to politics. And maybe it's a good forum for discussion relative to the things that how it weighs in on God's will. And let's talk about that, Don.
I'm trying to think about the serenity prayer. I accept the things I cannot change. Give me the courage to change what I can and know the difference.
Yeah.
And if I can't change it, then I just need to think about something else.
That's right.
Well,
I think I saw that on a plaque somewhere. But it's a good one.
No, it's a serenity prayer.
It's for the serenity prayer. Yeah.
The reason I get interested is, you know, the Bible tells us to obey the laws and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
But now whenever it finally gets to the point that they're trying to take my religion away, I'm not going to obey their laws.
Okay.
I don't care what. I'm going to go to church because obeying their law, I mean, there's so much laws that they got that's not according to what God wants.
So what you're saying is, though, keeping a perspective on what's important to God and being oriented on that.
Yeah.
And
they can pass all kinds of laws, but I'm not going to go along with it. You know what I'm saying.
Judy's serving everybody know this in here, okay?
I'm not going to go along with it.
And I respect that, Judy. So you know, I'm going to make light of what you're saying. And I've never known you be outspoken before, Judy. Why? How would you start?
There are friendships and families that people are divided over this.
Yeah.
Where they are just awful to one another, calling each other stupid and other names because they don't agree with who the
someone has named Jesus as their Lord? And is their allegiance to Christ as Lord, that they have set apart in their hearts Christ as Lord, or not? That's the big question, the cosmic question for us.
Is my hope in Christ, or is my hope in Trump?
Yeah. So, yes. Yeah. So anyway, this is my way of just kind of airing some of those things out, but an admonition for let's keep our perspective and stay oriented spiritually, whatever that needs to look like. We are in Acts chapter 21. You make your way there. The last slide that we had together, I think, was we talked about the Colossus of Rhodes, one of the early wonders of the world. Yeah, Bev, is there a mask on the left hand side of that? Yeah, let's see that. Okay. So they're properly distanced, you see, and I just kind of put some PPE on these guys just to be politically correct, since we're in a political environment. And also the Colossus on the right, I kind of cleaned them up a little bit, you know, with a little censoring there. So nobody knows what the Colossus of Rhodes looked like. Okay. The one on the left, and the reason we mentioned this is because Paul went right by Rhodes, and he probably would have seen the rubble from this if they pulled in there to stock up on supplies as he's on his way home from the third missionary journey. He would have seen the rubble of this gigantic statue where it had fallen. It stood for 60 some odd years, maybe ish, and then was toppled in an earthquake, and the big pieces lay there for 500 years, and it was a quiet tourist attraction, even falling down, and finally it was salvaged out of there. But it's known that they didn't really have the technology to make him sit astride the harbor. They would never have been able to do it. If he'd fallen, it would have blocked the harbor completely. So, but that's the Colossus of Rhodes. It's a neat National Geographic had a neat story on the construction of that thing and how that might have looked if you're ever interested in that. It's a neat thing, but and it's not mentioned in the scripture other than the mention of the island Rhodes where he went by, and that was at the end of our time last time. Here's the map, and so you see Paul heading home right around Rhodes, and then coming down around along Cyprus, and he's going to wind up in Tyre, and almost back home, trying to get home to Jerusalem by the Pentecost. He was in a hurry, okay, and we've talked about that. he's really wanting to get to Jerusalem. He doesn't know how long it's going to take him to get all the way from up to Ephesus, all the way around the horn and down there. And now he's close to home now. But when he was in Troas, he gets there and he's in a hurry, but he stays there for 7 days. And then it says, Acts 20 and 7 says, and on the first day of the week, they met together and they had communion. And a lot of commentators believe, and I think with some good reason, is that when Paul would land in some of these places, he would stay there. He would stay there a week or until the next opportunity comes so he could meet with the brethren on Sunday and have communion. That's a huge draw. And but beyond that, now back up just a second here, Bev. And so through the Spirit, okay, so they're at Tyre, okay? And they're meeting with the brethren. Maybe they perhaps they worshiped with them. I don't want to conjecture too much about that, but they spent a week, so I'm certain they did worship together. They spent a week, and this says, and through the Spirit, they were telling Paul not to go on to Jerusalem. Don't go. Through the Spirit. Okay, that's Acts 21 and 4. If we look back at a previous verse, the next one, I just want to compare these two. And this is Paul speaking on Acts chapter 20. Acts chapter 20 and 22. And now behold, I am going to Jerusalem, constrained, you might have bound, compelled by the Spirit, not knowing what will happen to me there.
What does that mean, Rick? Constrained by the Spirit or through the Spirit? What are they actually saying?
Well, through the knowledge of what the Holy Spirit wanted him to do. I think that's the simple way. And see, when Paul says here, constrained or bound or compelled by the Holy Spirit, he understood that it was the will of the Holy Spirit, the will of God, that he moved on to Jerusalem.
So why were we reading the entire different message?
Herein lies the question. Glad you brought it up. Good.
No answer.
And you know, the problem with bringing something up in class and asking questions is the teacher will say to you, well, what do you think about that? Yeah. Well, is there what kind of conflict should we feel from this, if any? What, okay? You've got Paul understanding in his mind, according to Acts 20 and 22, I'm bound for Jerusalem because I'm bound by the Holy Spirit of God to go there. So evidently that was his understanding. When he gets to Tyre, he has brethren, and this is not the only. And in the next few verses, we'll see other people discouraging from going to Jerusalem. Now, this is the only one that says through the Spirit. So how do we think about that? If they're through the Spirit telling him not to go, and the Holy Spirit has revealed to Paul that yes, this is where I want you to go. What means this? What do you think?
Spirit just a feeling?
No, that's the Holy Spirit, the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Mm-hmm. That's now, if you're asking how did the Holy Spirit direct these yeah. early Christians, I don't know that, other than we see sometimes, we see there was a come over to Macedonia and help us vision. Sometimes there was, and sometimes we don't know, it's just that we were going to go preach in this area in Bithynia, and the Holy Spirit closed the door for us to go there. There's some set of circumstances, but God made that known then. So I don't know exactly if you're asking that, Alice, yes. In this instance, Matt, Paul had been, in my mind, looking at this story, he'd been clearly aimed at, I'm going to Jerusalem. Well, he had the monetary gift, right, that he was taken back to them. We know that, and we know he was headed there. And when he says here, I'm bound by the Holy Spirit to do this, that's, you know, and that's pretty clear. That's pretty clear in this instance. You know, I mean, we can sin a lot and fear in a lot of ways, you know. But when the rubber meets the road, our commitment to the Lord and living that out, and whatever consequences come from that, that should supersede everything else. That's a point well taken. And if we're looking for little nuggets of application, when we look at our early church roots in Judea, and we know historically that did happen. And this is, and then he disappears, and we don't see him again until this time right here. A prophet named Agabus came down from Judea, and coming to us, he took Paul's belt. Paul gave that belt, stripped it off of him, I guess, and bound his own feet and hands, and said, "This is how it's going to look. Thus says the Holy Spirit, this is how the Jews at Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt." Now, we know the Holy Spirit's not just saying, if you go there, here's what's going to happen. And Agabus is not discouraging. He's saying, this is going to happen. This is set in stone. This is the will of God. And the person who owns this belt, this is going to happen to them. And that's Paul. This is how the Jews at Jerusalem will bind the man who owns this belt and deliver him into the hands of the Gentiles. And Luke says, when we heard this, by the way, it's not unusual for the prophets of God to act out stuff when they're giving the prophecy of God towards something that's going to happen. One famous example is in Ezekiel chapter 4, and God is prophesying, making the prophecy through Ezekiel about the siege of Jerusalem and how it's going to be, have a military siege set against it. And he says, Ezekiel, take you a big old brick, cinder block, and I want you to sit there, and I want you to write, this is Jerusalem on it, and then I want you to build up a miniature and make a little, almost like a little model battle, and you're going to build up a wooden rampart up to it, and you're going to dig this and these embattlements around it, and build up these wooden earthen berms, and then you're going to put an iron plate in front of it, and you're going to besiege against it. You're going to try to knock on that thing. And this is just illustrating prophecy in kind of a graphic form. Agabus strips off Paul's belt, or he gets Paul's belt from him, wraps it around his hands and his feet. We're going to see Paul in the not too distant future in Jerusalem. He's going to be bound with two chains, both on his hands and his feet, is the way I look at that. It's pretty remarkable, this prophecy. And he said, this is going to happen to the person that owns this belt. And here's, and all through from Tyre to Ptolemais to Caesarea, Paul's getting, don't do that. Don't put yourself in this situation. And Paul, I think you're right, bound and determined. See, verse 12, when we heard this, and this is Luke and his homies, his buddies, okay? When we heard this, we and the people there urged him not to go to Jerusalem. Now, this doesn't say through the Spirit here, but they're going, you're going to be in jail for sure. Stay out of that place. Paul bound and determined to go. Verse 13, he goes, you're killing me. Okay. Then Paul answered, what are you doing weeping and breaking my heart? For I'm ready not only to be in prison, but even to die in Jerusalem for the name of the Lord Jesus. And since he wouldn't be persuaded, we ceased and said, and this is a great little thing to say, let the will of the Lord be done. After these days, we got ready and went up to Jerusalem, and some of the disciples from Caesarea went with us, bringing us to the house of Mason of Cyprus, an early disciple with whom we should lodge. Okay. Pretty neat and indicative of exactly what's going to happen with Paul. So he goes in with his eyes wide open with people that care about him saying, don't do it. But he says, the Holy Spirit bound me to do this. Call it a little bit or whatever, but once Paul had made it, that thing was right for him, and in this case, instructed by the Holy Spirit, he's going to do it, irregardless. Let's look at, so he gets to Jerusalem. We're down to verse 17. Let's pick up there. When we come to Jerusalem, the brothers received us gladly. On the following day, Paul went in with us to James. Now, this is the brother of Jesus, half-brother of Jesus, maybe technically. But James was a prominent leader in that early church. He would have been, being brother of the Lord. Went in with us to James, and all the elders were present. We don't get mention of the other apostles in this And so they glorified God. You see that when they heard it, they glorified God, verse 20. Now look, this begins a section that's pretty interesting here, and I want to probe your thinking about that here in the time we have left. So they're glad to hear all that. And they say, look, we've got a situation going on here. You've got some bad press on you because, you know, you're preaching salvation apart from the law of Moses. Okay, we get that, but people feel a certain way about that, and we need to address this. Now, you determine for yourself whether they are oriented and worried about the proper things, okay, this church leadership, and the part that Paul plays in this, what does it surprise you? I guess I'll just ask that, okay? When they heard it, they glorified God, and they said to him, "You see, brother, how many thousands of Jews there, how many thousands there are among the Jews of those who have believed, and they're all zealous for the law." Now, this is a little snapshot of the Jerusalem church. Thousands and thousands. We conjectured, and commentators say there may have been 15, 20,000 or more Christians, and that was by Acts chapter 6. Who knows what might have happened since that time? Thousands and thousands. And struggling for a place to meet and distribution of food and how to get along and supporting each other and all that. And it must have been neat, but look, they are. If you're Jewish, you have come up, and for generations, you are bound in those Jewish traditions. How easy would it be to say, okay, I've done all that? No, that doesn't happen with us. We are part of all that we have met, as Tennyson said. So it's ingrained in them, and this was the flavor of the church there. Okay? They're believers in Christ, but they still have all this history with the law of Moses. Okay? Verse 21, and they have all been told about you, Paul, that you teach all the Jews who are among the Gentiles to forsake Moses, toss him out on his ear, and you tell them not to circumcise their children or to walk according to our customs. Now, they were concerned still about circumcision. We saw this back in chapter 15. Concerned about circumcision and about the customs of the law of Moses. So what's then to be done? They will certainly hear that you have come. Let's hear one more. So, I mean, what you see, what you think about this developing here. So, James and the elders of the Jerusalem church of thousands asked Paul to do this. So, do therefore what we tell you, okay? We have four guys who are under a vow. We'll talk about that vow a little bit next time and maybe what we might know about it. Under a vow. Take these men and purify yourself along with them and pay their expenses. And you had to do this at the temple so that they may shave their heads. We don't know if Paul shaved his head in this instance, but history tells us Paul was bald, you know, this oral tradition. Gives me some hope, but at least we know he was part of the time from other passages, okay? But thus all will know, everybody will know if you do this with these guys, that there's nothing in what they've been told about you, but that you also live in observance of the law. And here's the kicker. Here's what this what they suggested. And what did Paul do? We have one more. Then Paul took them in, and the next day he purified himself along with them and went into the temple, giving notice when the days of purification would be fulfilled and the offering would be presented for each of them. Paul, the guy who had this big argument with these same leaders back in chapter 15 and said, look, we're not constrained by the law of Moses. He's going into the